lecture on acute conditions. Light ban karo. On acute conditions and emergencies in ENT. Initially, I was told to take the lecture only on emergencies in ENT. But when we realized that if there are acute emergencies like severe stridor or so, patients come directly to the hospitals. So, I wanted to cover few acute topics because these patients generally come to general practitioners. As general practitioners, you have to deal with the entire body. The patients come with different symptoms for the entire part of the body. So, sometimes when these conditions or these acute conditions of ENT, they come to you, it becomes difficult to diagnose or it becomes sometimes confusing to diagnose what exactly is the condition. And as first aid, what should be given to treat the patient acutely in that condition, to treat the patient from his symptoms or relieve him from the symptoms. So, we will try to understand. Definitely in this half an hour, we won't be, able to go into depth of each and every topic, which is not the idea of this lecture. The idea of this lecture or this topic is that we all together try to understand when a patient with acute symptoms comes to us. In our mind, we should think of possible common diagnosis and the first aim should be, if we have diagnosed, to relieve the patient of that symptom. Further diagnosis and definitive management can be done. But mainly today, we will try to understand what can be the common differential diagnosis in acute conditions, what is the basic or first aid treatment, and more than that, what not should be done, what should not be done in those conditions which can harm the patient more, and which conditions are a definitive refer to a specialized center. So, before this, I always start that all practitioners should have these basic ENT instruments at their setup, at least one otoscope, a good headlight, because when we have a headlight, we can use both our hands to examine the throat, we can use instruments to remove foreign body. So, it is a basic that all of us should now start using headlights when we examine instead of just using a torch, because when we use a torch, our one hand gets occupied. So, we just have one hand to remove a foreign body or examine the patient. We should have an otoscope, a curved forceps, because when we take a plain thumb forceps to remove something from the nose or ear, our hands come in between. So, if we have a curved forceps, our hands will not come in the view and it is better to remove a foreign body or even do a simple dressing in the ear or nose. So, have a curved forceps, we call it Tilly's forceps, just a dressing forceps is enough, a headlight. And this is something, a Eustachian tube catheter, which again I also tell in most of the lectures that it is very important that we start removing. I know many practitioners, they remove nasal foreign bodies. And instead of using a forceps, using this instrument to remove the foreign body from nose, it becomes extremely easy and very less chance that you will push the foreign body behind. There is a probe to clean the ear, especially of discharge. If there is a lot of discharge in the ear, you can clean this with the probe. And definitely a tongue depressor to examine the entire part of oral cavity. If a patient comes with some oral problems, just seeing the mouth will not solve the purpose. Using a tongue depressor, retracting the cheek and seeing the gingiva and buccal mucosa also becomes important. So, these are few, yes sir. Sir, vectus again is slightly sharp and curved. So, this is a totally blunt substance. So, definitely suppose the foreign body does not come out, at least will not damage the mucosa of nasal cavity. So, because in children, the moment you touch the mucosa, it starts bleeding. And the moment blood starts more than us, the parents start panicking. So, better to have a blunt object. If at all foreign body does not come out, our aim should be that it should not be pushed behind and the chance of bleeding should be minimized. So, there is high chance that vectus, a curved wire, can cause damage compared to a blunt object. So, I would suggest to use a Eustachian tube catheter and we all use this to remove the foreign body. Okay, so these are the basic things that we expect that all of us should have it to have a good ENT setup. Now we come to few acute conditions of the ear and I will not go symptom wise, I will not go diagnosis wise, I will go symptom wise that you are in the OPD, a patient has come to you with severe ear pain. The first aim or you are at night and you get a call from a patient, known patient of yours that Dr. Mala khub kanat dukhta hai, I have got severe pain or my child is having severe pain, which I am sure many of you would be getting such phone calls. And the immediate reaction is to give some ear drops. That becomes the first reaction. So, first of all, when a patient comes with symptoms of severe ear pain, we should understand there can be many, many causes. But we should know that these three or four are the most common cause. And even if blindly you write any of these, at least 25% of the time you are right. So, whenever a patient with severe ear pain comes to you, try to diagnose the condition, the first thing that you should do is, I always say, is go for a tragus tenderness. Let the patient sit there, put the finger on tragus and press the tragus. If patient has severe pain on touching the pinna or pressing the tragus, it means that we are dealing with otitis externa. When we are examining a patient and patient has severe ear pain on touching, we are dealing with otitis externa. It can be a simple boil in the ear canal, it can be a boil inside, or it can be an extensive boil which is completely making the ear canal narrow. So, first thing, when a patient of ear pain comes to you, examine, before examining, just touch or put your finger on the tragus. If patient has severe pain, most of the time I am sure you are dealing with a case of otitis externa, and otitis externa can be just two causes, one is bacterial and one is fungus. This is the fungal otitis externa, which is also called as otomycosis, and this is the bacterial otitis externa where patient has a boil, most commonly caused by staph aureus. So instead of giving a ear drop, better to start a good amoxiclav antibiotic for this patient and to give any topical ointment. It can be plain povidone iodine, can be plain soframycin with or without steroid, but a topical ointment will do better in this condition. If you see a boil, if you don't see a boil and still patient has tragal tenderness, it is quite possible that patient might be having a otomycosis, deep seated fungus inside the ear. In that case, as a first aid, please don't give any antibiotic ear drops. If at all, if you think giving an antifungal drop will not harm the patient, but if it is fungus and you are giving an antibiotic ear drops or a wax solvent, the fungus will definitely increase. So if you are in doubt, no harm in giving an antifungal drop rather than an antibiotic drop. And yes, remember, wax. Wax will never ever cause acute pain in the ear. Wax will never cause acute pain. So many times patients go to the medical store, pharmacies over the counter, and they get wax solvents for ear pain. Remember, that will not solve the purpose, especially if it is a fungus or a bacterial infection, it will again increase the infection. So it is not advisable to use a wax solvent drops. Yes, an impacted wax which is pressing on the ear canal, it will lead to severe pain, which is called as keratosis obturans, which is a very, very impacted wax. Again, removing this is also not advisable, because this patient is in severe pain. The moment you use a probe to touch or remove the wax, even if you touch this wax, patient will wince in severe pain. So removing wax is not advisable when patient has severe pain. If you feel and if you see too much of wax in the ear canal, instead of wax solvent drops, and if you think that there is no fungus, no bacteria, instead of wax solvent drops, better to give an analgesic and relieve the patient of pain. Once the pain subsides, in that case, you can give a wax solvent drops and try to remove it, or refer to a center where we can remove this wax by a microscopy or suctioning. Removing simple wax is definitely not advisable in any acute conditions of pain. So, for pain, we understood that rule out otitis externa, which is a boil, or fungus. Especially in monsoon season, June, July, if a patient comes with severe pain, some false smelling discharge, most of the time it is otomycosis. Give an antifungal drop and analgesic. In otomycosis, if you can see a cotton wool like deposits, sometimes we feel that cotton is there inside, just see to it that it is fungus. Give antifungal drop, give analgesic, and most of time patient will become better. Second, if the ear pain, there is no tragal tenderness, but patient is having giving a history of recurrent upper respiratory infection, or he has had recurrent infection recently, he is on some antibiotics or decongestant for common cold, more likely in children. So patient has come with severe ear pain, there is no tragal tenderness, and when you take a short history, he says, yes, I have been suffering from some cold, some nasal discharge. You are dealing with a ASOM. You are dealing with acute suppurative otitis media. So just two causes of acute pain. One is otitis externa, which can be bacterial or fungal. And second is acute suppurative otitis media, which is because of common cold, because of upper respiratory infection, the infection travels from the nose, goes in the ear. A normal tympanic membrane, you don't even require an otoscope to see it. Even with a headlight or with a torch, if you just pull the pinna upward and outward, you can see a wide glistening tympanic membrane if there is no wax. So normal tympanic membrane, which is pearly white, if you see that it is a reddish or completely dark red color tympanic membrane and patient has severe ear pain, and patient is having a history of recurrent upper respiratory infection, we are dealing with acute respiratory otitis media, especially in children. Because children have severe pain, they keep crying. Because of crying, the eustachian tube further gets congested and the symptom further gets aggravated. So if a child comes at night or a parent call you at night and say that my child has got severe ear pain, instead of prescribing ear drops, in your mind, think that yes, it can be otitis media, which is more common in children. Start again amoxicillin antibiotic, which is a safe thing and analgesic. So the take home point for ear pain is that never ever prescribe wax solvent drops in ear pain and never give those combination drops, those which contains antibiotics, which contains lignocaine, which contains antifungal and which contains steroid. So don't use combination drops in ear pain. If at all you want to relieve the patient from the pain, better to give an analgesic tablet, analgesic syrup and a basic antibiotic, because now we know that severe ear pain will just be two causes. One is otitis externa and one is ASOM. These are common two causes. There can be many few other causes also, but these two are the most common cause. And as a general practitioner, if these patients come to you, these two will be the most common cause, and treating with a basic antibiotic and analgesic is more advisable than giving any drops. So if one take home message for ear pain, it should be that we should not give wax solvent drops and we should not give those combination drops, because sometimes combination drops will increase the fungus, combination drops will increase the infection in the ear and will lead to more pain and irritation. So first point about otalgia. Second is ear foreign body. There are various kinds of foreign body in the ear which can happen, and patients come at night giving us history that some insect has gone inside the ear. The first, or when or you are in a clinic and patient comes with an insect in the ear, in that case, first of all, calm the patient, because patients always feel that the insect can perforate the drum and can go in the brain. It never happens. An insect never will perforate the, even if the patient has a middle ear tympanic membrane perforation, the insect will maximum stay in the middle ear. It will not go beyond that. So first of all, calm the patient. The insect is not going to kill the patient. It is not a die-hard emergency. But yes, a flying insect in the ear, fluttering inside, patient may have too much of irritation. Emergency-wise, if the insect is still alive, just put that ear in which the insect has gone down and try to shake the head, because more than the patient, the insect wants to come out. So the insect will try to come out from the ear. Still, after doing this, if it is not coming out, best is to put some normal saline, plain, not warm, normal saline, or if you have liquid paraffin or any oil in your clinic, just put that in the ear. Insect is not dangerous. It is the moving of insect which causes pain or irritation to the patient, which causes him problem. So our aim is to kill the insect. Don't try to remove a live insect with a forceps, because the moment you touch it, it will start going inside and cause more problem. So first of all, just put the head down. The insect will come out by gravity or by itself. If it does not come out in 2-3 seconds, just put some normal saline or put some drops that will kill the insect in the ear. And then if you can see those legs of the insect with a plain, those foreign body forceps which we saw initially, you can just try to pull it out. If you think that the entire insect has come out, well and good. But sometimes, because of water, some part stay inside, some part come out. So in that case, you can send to us with a suction or microscope, we can remove the rest of the insect. But first thing is, don't try to remove the insect with a forceps if the insect is live. There can be various other foreign bodies also. Like sometimes children can put a small nut or beans, or there can be a sponge. A lot of time erasers children put. Sometimes there are small stone particles while playing, they put inside a wheat grain, rice grain, something can be there. So remember, generally foreign body we divide into organic or vegetative and inorganic or non-vegetative. That is, these foreign body, if you try to flush with saline, with syringing, these will swell up. And if they don't come out, they will cause more pain, more block sensation. So remember, ear foreign body is not an emergency. Patient might feel that something has gone inside, can cause problem, but calm the patient down. It is not life-threatening. It will not cause any severe problem. Even if it stays for 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, it will not cause too much of problem. So if it is a nut or a bean or something which you think will swell up with water, don't attempt syringing. Don't try to put water in the ear to take it out. However, if it's a stone, a sponge or eraser or a cotton bowl, cotton or sponge, you can try to take out with a forceps or something like an eraser. If you are little bit trained in syringing, I'm sure most of you will do syringing, but remember, if the syringing is a very simple process, just take a 20 ml syringe, just take a 20 ml syringe. On the tip of it, attach the cut part of a Ryle's tube, the tip part of a Ryle's tube on it, so it remains soft, and you can just flush the water in the ear. But before flushing, just take a history. That patient should not be having history of ear discharge, because if patient has an ear discharge, that is CSOM, and if you are putting more water inside, he may go into severe giddiness. He can have more middle ear infection. So if patient is very clear cut, he says, no, I have never had ear discharge from my ear, you can try removing these foreign bodies like a stone or eraser with syringing. 20 ml syringe, just first flush water inside. Maximum is it will not come out, but it will not cause any damage to the patient. But if it is these foreign bodies like a small groundnut or nut, if you put water, if it does not come out, then it swells up and then it can cause problem. So syringing should be attempted with a 20 ml syringe only if they are inorganic foreign bodies which you are sure will not swell up. If it is a cotton or a sponge-like thing, you can always take a forceps. Or you can always take a forceps and remove it if it is seen clearly. Do not use earbuds to remove forceps, remove foreign body. Earbuds will never, we will never be able to remove foreign body with earbuds, and no sharp instruments. Those wax removal forceps, they are not for foreign body removal. Don't use sharp instruments. Always use a forceps or use syringing. Just two ways in which a clinic setup you can remove the foreign body. Don't use any sharp object to remove it, because the moment you use sharp object, if it does not come out, and is a child, if it keeps moving, there is chance that you can damage the skin. If blood comes out, again it's not life threatening, but it causes more panic in the parents, that it is more that too much of blood coming from the ear. That panic needs to be avoided. So first of all, calm the patient down. It's not an emergency. Try to remove with a forceps, depending on what foreign body it is. And that will solve the purpose. If it does not come out, you can refer to us. We have got microscope, we have got endoscopes, we have got suctions with which we can remove the entire foreign body, preserving the eardrum. But most important is to calm the patient and tell the patient ear foreign body is not an emergency. That needs to be given given to the patient. Then there is one emergency, which is sudden sensory neural hearing loss. This requires a specialized ENT care, but from your side, it requires the immediate diagnosis. So a lot of time patient comes to you, maybe coming to you or comes to us with history of sudden loss of hearing. He was totally all right, and then immediately or within 1 or 2 hours, he totally lost his hearing, or his hearing has gone totally down. There can be many causes. Sometimes even a wax and some water going inside, the wax will swell up and patient will have a blocked sensation. Sometimes even because of cold, the ear will get blocked. A patient has taken a flight, he has got upper respiratory infection, ear gets blocked. So there can be many conditions. Those can be treated at your level. But when it is a sudden sensory neural hearing loss, he requires urgent audiometry, he requires high dose of steroids. So how to diagnose it? So I would suggest all of you definitely keep a tuning fork for a central nervous examination. Keep a 512 hertz tuning fork also, 512 hertz. Just strike it on your elbow or your knee and put on the mastoid. No need to do Rini's, Weber, all those tests. No need to go into detail. Just take the tuning fork, put on the mastoid of the patient. Vibrate and put on the mastoid of the patient. If patient is hearing well, if patient says, I am hearing well, there are very less chances it may be sudden hearing loss. But if patient says that he is not hearing on the mastoid part, then think that yes, it can be a case of sudden hearing loss. And initial 3 or 4 days are extremely important. Because what happens is, when patient comes with hearing loss, we see some wax, we can give some wax, we give some wax solvent drops, some basic antibiotic analgesics. But if it is sudden hearing loss, we are losing that 3, 4, 5 days period in which patient can almost recover his hearing. So if patient comes with sudden hearing loss, you have taken tuning fork, put on the mastoid, and patient says that he is not hearing, better that it can be a sudden hearing loss, refer to a patient. We will do audiometries, and we have a criteria for diagnosis whereby we see that at least 30 decibel hearing loss is there, neural loss is there, and patient needs a high dose of steroids, a dose of acyclovir, and sometimes he also requires intra-ear, intra-tympanic steroids. So this is one thing which I want all of you to understand, because this is still not taken as an emergency. Patient comes to us with hearing loss, but this is a totally recoverable. Patient can recover if the proper treatment starts in 3 or 4 days. Vertigo. A patient having severe vertigo, a patient of vertigo comes to you with these kinds of features. When we keep seeing such slides constantly, we have this rotatory or imbalance kind of feeling. So whenever vertigo comes to us, again, we have a doubt whether is it a central cause, should we get an MRI done, Should we refer to ENT? Should they give basic tablets like a Vertin or a Semitil? What should be done in case of vertigo? So, 2 or 3 minutes of subtle history will help us. So, what is to be asked to the patient is the lot of time patient are not sure what vertigo is. So, ask the patient the type of vertigo. If it is a rotatory, if everything is rotating, either the patient is rotating or the surrounding is rotating, either of them. In that case, it has to be more or less a ear origin vertigo. So the cause is from the ear. If it is an imbalance, like an alcoholic, drunkard person, if the patient is having imbalance, which patient can call greediness vertigo, more or less it is a central cause, a brain cause of vertigo. And if patient has blackouts or patient has generalized weakness, then it can be a cardiac cause, it can be diabetes, hypoglycemia, it can be anemia, it can be general vasovagal attack. So just take a detailed history for 2-3 minutes. Ask the patient whether it is a rotatory kind of vertigo or a generalized imbalance. If it is a sudden onset rotatory vertigo and patient has severe vomiting along with that, it is a definitely ear cause vertigo, and the first aim instead of diagnosis should be to relieve the patient of vertigo, and prochlorperazine injection or tablets are good, which commonly is Semitil, or there are many brands available. So prochlorperazine injection tablets are important if it is a rotatory kind of vertigo, in that case only. Other conditions it may not be effective, but a rotatory vertigo with vomiting, immediate aim should be to treat the patient, especially if vertigo is lasting for more than 30 minutes. If patient recovers, very good, you can further diagnose the patient. Otherwise, you can, in our center, what we do is we have various tests by which various ear conditions can be diagnosed. It can be a postural vertigo by Dick-Solpak test. We have got audiometry whereby we can check the hearing loss. There can be various causes. But as an acute condition, it is important that we treat the patient with, relieve the patient of that vertigo sensation, because it is a very, very dreadful condition with severe vertigo. Whether MRI to be advised immediately or not. Remember, if patient has sudden onset vertigo, if he is completely all right and suddenly he starts having vertigo or imbalance like condition, that is an indication for MRI. If patient has a rotatory vertigo, we can wait. Still he may require MRI, but we can wait. But if he has sudden onset, he was completely all right, sudden onset imbalance with some weakness, that is an indication that better to get MRI brain with or without contrast done and then refer to a neurologist. But a rotatory vertigo, MRI can wait, treat the patient initially, and more than 30 minutes, severe vertigo, please admit the patient, keep the patient for observation. So those were the few things about ear, which are acute conditions like ear pain, hearing loss, which can, or vertigo, which can trouble us in our OPD. Coming to conditions of nose. Very important. Like there was otitis externa in the ear. Similarly, if a boil happens in the nose, it is called as vestibulitis. The skin lined area of the nose is vestibule. So whenever there is a boil in the vestibule, a boil anywhere else in the body, we can take it easy. But when a boil is there on the nose, especially in the skin part of the nose, it is very important that we treat this condition aggressively. When we say aggressive management, because the lower part of nose and the upper part of lip, this area of the face is called as the dangerous area of the face. And why do we call it dangerous? Because the infection from this area, from the venous drainage, can directly go into cavernous sinus, can directly go into brain, patient can go into severe meningitis and can become fatal. So whenever there is a vestibulitis, a boil in the ear, and patient will have excruciating severe pain in the nose, there is no other reason when patient will have pain on the nose except for trauma and a boil. Patient can have a facial pain in sinusitis, patient can have a headache, but if the patient has face pain on the nose, you touch the nose and patient has pain, there can be just two causes. One is trauma and one is vestibulitis. So the moment you see a boil, many times patient says severe pain, you cannot see a boil. Most of the time, there may be a boil somewhere deep inside the nose in a small hair follicle. In those conditions, give patient an antibiotic ointment instead of drops, instead of those nasoclear drops. Give a patient some antibiotic ointment to apply inside the nose. Tell him to take on a bud's or in his finger and apply it liberally inside. Even if it goes inside, no problem. So those antibiotic drops, antibiotic ointment can be applied safely inside the nose. If it is a frank pus pointing is there, take a 11 number blade, give a small nick like any other IND, the pus will come out, and start the patient on a broad spectrum antibiotic analgesic. It is very important that patient has come to us with pain. We diagnose, don't diagnose, at least we need to relieve the pain. So it is important to give a patient good analgesic. If we see a boil, put the patient, common cause is staph aureus, so put the patient on amoxiclav antibiotic with a higher dose, depending on the patient's weight. Nowadays, 1 gram are also available. So if you see a boil in the nose, adult patient, better to give a 1 gram antibiotic rather than a 625 milligram antibiotic. So aggressive treatment of vestibulitis is extremely important. Epistaxis. Again, these are few cases. These are cases which either they can be severe bleeding from the nose, or there are patients who keep coming to us with recurrent nasal bleed, that it bleeds for a few minutes, it stops by itself, again it keeps happening. And they say it can be because of summer, because it is happening since childhood. Remember, majority of ear bleed, even those which occur in summer, which occur in extreme winters, are always because of trauma. It is always because of trauma. In extreme summer also, because of the dry air, the nose, nasal mucosa becomes totally dry. And in that condition, if child touches the nose, plays with the nose, in that case, those dry mucosa start bleeding. So, majority of causes of nasal bleed is always trauma. In adults, there can be hypertension also. But the problem is when he comes with severe nasal bleed, the patient and relatives are extremely anxious. When they are anxious, the blood pressure is again started to go high, and that will further lead to more bleeding. So, instead of making the patient lie down, let the patient sit. The emergency should be let the patient sit, look down or put slightly head up and press the nose. Whenever we have any bleeding in any part of the body, it can be hand, leg, anywhere, we tie a tight bandage. Same thing should be done in nose also. Whenever there is a nasal bleed, just press the nose and let the patient sit, because if the patient lies down, sometimes the blood will keep trickling inside. So let the patient sit, pinch the nose, and whatever blood, if at all, coming in the throat, tell the patient to spit it out, so we know how much blood loss is happening. Majority of bleeding will get controlled only with nasal pinching, but we should keep it for 7 to 10 minutes. Just keeping it for 1 minute, again checking whether bleeding has stopped, will not work. So pinch the nose for 7 to 10 minutes, majority of bleeding will stop. Also, there is a notion of packing the nose with adrenaline pack, with cotton or gauze piece. Stop that. Nowadays, we have got ready-made packs. They are very safe. They are very easy to insert. Most of you insert Ryle's tube very, very comfortably. It is same like putting a Ryle's tube. Just take this pack. They are available ready-made in most of the medical shops. If it is only in case of severe nasal bleed, severe, minimal bleed, don't pack. Severe nasal bleed, you have put pressure. It is not stopping. It is flowing too much. In that case, these nasal packs are there. You can simply apply a normal betadine ointment and put it inside as if you are inserting a Ryle's tube. Just go along the floor and put it inside. They are available in 8 cm and 10 cm. 8 cm is good for Indian adult, male and female. So, 8 cm, these nasal packs are good only in case of profuse bleeding. Don't put packs in case of minor bleed. Most of those will stop. And if you think there is minimal bleed, you can just put a cotton or gauze, but with either paraffin betadine, but don't put adrenaline, because adrenaline will again further aggravate the bleeding if at all. So don't put adrenaline pack, use these packs for profuse bleeding or minimal gauze piece if there is little bit of bleeding. There are various facial trauma patients also may also be coming to you in your hospitals. It can be a nasal fracture, it can be various facial fractures. Remember, in a facial fracture, instead of managing fracture, the first important thing is to manage the airway and control the bleeding, because in these conditions, patient might have a maxilla fracture, might have a mandible fracture, and these bleeding might be happening and coming out from the nose or from the mouth. So, first important thing is to manage the airway. If patient is having polytrauma of the face, in those conditions, intubations become difficult. In those cases, you can refer for tracheostomy. But if patient is stable, airway-wise is stable, in that case, but he is having severe bleed, because there can be a sphenoid fracture, there can be a maxilla fracture, all these will come out from the nose like nasal bleed. In that case, those nasal packs which we showed are again good. We can just insert inside the nose and majority of time the bleeding will stop. In these conditions, again, it is important to diagnose what fracture the patient has. If the patient does not have any other facial fracture, just a blunt trauma on the nose, and if you see some deviation, the only way to diagnose facial nasal bone fracture is touch the nose, try to move the nose. First of all, you'll have a lot of pain. If you little bit move it, you will find some crepitous sound, some crackling sound will be there. That will confirm the diagnosis of fracture nasal bone. We don't even require an x-ray for that. X-ray is just for medical legal purpose or to show to a patient. But a crackling sound on moving the nose is a very important thing. If the nose is straight, in spite of the fracture, we don't treat it aggressively. It heals by itself. We treat a fracture nasal bone only if there is a deformity in the nose after the fracture. Similarly, maxilla fracture, mandible fracture, zygomatic fractures, also we are treating, we can, once you diagnose this condition, to diagnose them, okay, one more thing which we have seen is patient, most of times patients are advised x-ray PNS Waters view. Remember, Waters view is not for fracture nasal bone. Waters view is only for sinuses. If you want to advise or check for fracture nasal bone, go for x-ray skull lateral view, a lateral view, and tell the radiologist or technician to focus on nasal bone. That is the ideal way of diagnosing. X-ray PNS is not, it is only for sinuses and definitely no role in a facial trauma. If you want to rule out maxilla mandible fracture, go for a CT scan face. Don't write sinuses. Write CT scan face and tell the technician to go for a 3D reconstruction of face so we can know exactly which part of the bone is damaged and whether it requires active plating management or a conservative management will do. So it is important at your end or in your hospitals to at least reach to a diagnosis what kind of facial fracture is there. And then if it is a typical fracture which requires a lot of plating and all, you can refer to us. Definitely we manage these conditions. But important is, first is control the bleeding. And before that, if it is a facial trauma, manage the airway. Nasal foreign body. Again, a lot of children, they put a lot of things inside, various things inside the nose. And they keep coming to us. The problem is how to remove it. Never ever use a forceps. Like in ear, we had advised that we should use a forceps to take it out. But in nose, never ever use a forceps to take it out. Best is to use a Eustachian tube catheter, which is a blunt, which is blunt on one end. Even if you are seeing the foreign body, even if you see outside, don't remove with a forceps. It is very tempting to hold it and take it out. But most of the time, these foreign body patients are children. The moment you touch it, they will move around and it gets pushed inside. And once it gets pushed inside, more than children, more than us, the parents start panicking, where is it gone? Has it gone in the airway? Has it gone in stomach? So if at all it is seen, don't ever use a forceps to take it out. Use these kinds of catheters which are readily available. Just put it inside. Remember, when you put this instrument inside, minimal trauma is not going to cause any problem. Especially this is a blunt end. It will not cause too much of trauma. So just insert it above the foreign body. So once you see, and mind you, these things should be tried only if you are seeing a foreign body. If the parent says that he has put something inside and if you are not seeing, don't attempt this. If you are seeing a foreign body, take this forceps and try, take this instrument and try to go above the foreign body. Side going below will not help. If you are able to go above the foreign body and then pull it out, that is the easiest way to take out. First of all, if you are going above, you will not be pushing it inside and pulling out becomes easier. First attempt is the best attempt. If it does not come out, leave it. You can send to a specialized center. You can either give a GA, short GA, or remove it by suctioning or by holding the patient. But first attempt, just attempt once. I would not suggest attempt many times to remove it because child is now panicked. He's having pain. He will keep moving more. And high chance of losing the foreign body, high chance of foreign body going inside. And though not common, but yes, there is little bit chance that this nasal foreign body can go in the bronchus if child, because child is crying. And when the child is crying, when he breathes heavily inside, it can get stuck inside the airway. So just use one attempt to use a catheter and take it out by going above. This should be the message from today. Coming to our throat conditions. A lot of time patient comes with severe throat pain, high grade fever. Severe throat pain, high grade fever. If we examine throat, we can find congested tonsils, can be acute tonsillitis, we can treat them. I'm sure all of you are treating those conditions, acute pharyngitis, acute tonsillitis. But remember, if the patient has severe throat pain, high grade fever, and along with that, he also has trismus. Trismus meaning not able to open the mouth. The moment you tell the patient to open the mouth, if he has severe throat pain, high grade fever and trismus, that he is not able to open the mouth, remember, it cannot be acute tonsillitis. It has to be something else along with the tonsil, along with the deep neck space. It can be a quincy, like a pus collection on the side of tonsil. It can be some kind of parapharyngeal abscess, which you can even see in the neck, or it can be Ludwig's abscess, which is in the submandibular area, or it can be a retropharynx, that is pushed behind in the posterior pharyngeal wall. So, severe throat pain, high-grade fever, trismus, patient says he is not able to swallow, saliva keeps coming out, it is an abscess somewhere in the neck. Better to refer to a center where, or at least admit the patient and call for a specialist, because this abscess needs to be ruled out, and these are all abscesses which can burst and which can go in the airway and patient can go into stridor. And intubation in all these conditions becomes difficult, especially if you have taken the OT. So managing high grade fever, trismus, drooling saliva, and if at all patient has some difficulty in breathing, always admit the patient, call for a specialist help, because these require specialized attention, and tackling these patients on OPD basis is not advisable. Foreign body in the throat. A lot of times children swallow coin or some other things in the mouth and it gets stuck. Most commonly the foreign body or the coin will get stuck in the upper part of the esophagus. Most common is stuck in the upper part of the esophagus, because if it goes in the throat, he will have very severe stridor. If it goes in the airway, he will have very severe stridor. And those patients will come to a hospital. But if it is in the esophagus or the upper esophagus, they will have just history of foreign body. When you get an x-ray done, you will find a coin sitting there in the upper part of the esophagus. You should, yes, attempt the Hemlich maneuver. It is just stand behind the patient, put your two hands, left hand on your right hand, press on the Zippy sternum and press with both the hands on the Zippy sternum with patient facing down. So pressing on Zippy sternum with lot of pressure, like as we do in CPR on the chest, we do this in the Zippy sternum, in the soft area, and patient bending down. There are chances that this foreign body can be coughed out or taken out. One or two attempts of Hemlich maneuver, it is not coming out. Refer to us, we have endoscopes, we have esophagoscopes, whereby we remove it. But if the patient has stridor with a foreign body, if he is having difficulty in breathing, it means that the foreign body is in the airway and he requires a very immediate management. He should be referred, because airway foreign body, the child or the patient can lose his life, because if it is in trachea, he can definitely lose his life. If it is too much of time, it is blocking the trachea. If it goes in one bronchus, he is safe. But if it is in trachea, it is very difficult to manage if it is impacting the entire trachea. So any foreign body history with difficulty in breathing, good to refer to a center. If it is esophagus, you can still go send for x-ray. You can send for try a Hemlich maneuver and then refer if it does not come out. If it is a foreign body history, there is a tendency from a patient to ask, that should I feed the patient bananas? Should I give water to the patient? Remember, if it is a large foreign body, avoid giving any feed to the patient. Keep the patient NBM till he is comfortable or till the foreign body comes out. A small thing like a fish or something, patient says he has taken fish and got stuck inside. You can try with your with antacids or giving bananas or giving liquids to the patient. But a large foreign body causing difficulty in swallowing, because suppose there is a foreign body stuck on the esophagus upper part and child takes liquid, child takes banana, there is chance that he can start aspirating also. So a large foreign body, avoid advising patients to take any feeds. A small foreign body like a fish or something, you can try with bananas or liquids. In airway, as we discussed, if patient has severe breathing problem, always refer, because that is life threatening and patient can lose his life. So to sum up, that was all I wanted to explain or understand today, is that these are few conditions related to, there can be many things, but these are few conditions related to ENT which come to all of us, which come to general practitioner OPD, where sometimes more than diagnosis, first of all, relieving the patient becomes important. We need to have few tips what to give, what, especially what not to do to aggravate these conditions. Ear pain, hearing loss, trauma, epistaxis, foreign body, stridor, you should be aware of basic points. And when you treat, in your mind, I don't say that reach to diagnosis, but at least have two or three differential diagnoses, that we are treating two or three these kinds of conditions. Just as a patient of high-grade fever comes, in your mind it can be fever, viral fever, pharyngitis, UTI. So similarly, when a patient of ear pain comes to you, you should think, is it otitis externa, is it fungus, is it boil, what is it inside? And so when you are treating any symptom, instead of trying to treat that just that symptom, yes, we need to treat the symptom, but instead of trying to treat just the symptom, try to reach to at least one or two differential diagnoses and then treat that patient. That will make the patient more happier. And also, because most of patients, they come to us, they are filtered from physicians, general practitioners, pediatricians. So if this basic knowledge is there, it is a good patient care that we can give to the patient. And definitely refer when a specialized management is required. So many patients with these symptoms come to you, reach to a diagnosis and try to treat those patients at your level. Thank you so much. We are all here in our department. We have a good group of faculties in ENT department. Any problem, you can call us the department number. Definitely we'll be ready to help you. If you send any patient to us, please write your name on that so that we can give you a feedback what the patient had and how the patient was treated. Open to any questions if you have. Thank you.